Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I am Dr. Muhammad Adnan, working as Assistant Professor in the Department of Physics, Kohat University of Science and Technology. I welcome you to the course PHY352, Nuclear Physics 1. Today, it is the 13th lecture of this course, and the topic is angular moments in the nucleus. First, I will give the learning objective. At the end of this lecture, the student will understand how the angular momentum of nucleons are defined via the quantum mechanics. In this course, we are following the book Introductory Nuclear Physics by Kenneth S. Crane, 3rd edition. In this lecture, I have taken some of the illustration from this book. Okay, first we'll go through some of the background of the angular momentum, and this angular momentum will be discussed regarding the various nuclei. But we will see some of the background of the angular momentum before we proceed. Another important thing is that we will borrow the idea of the, or we can say the mathematical definitions of the angular momentum from the quantum mechanics that you have already done in the course of quantum mechanics and also atomic and molecular physics. And here we will discuss some of the outcomes. Now, in classical mechanics, the angular momentum L of a particle moving with a linear momentum P at a location r around a reference point is given by vector L equal to the vector r cross vector P, where this the moment arm and this is the linear momentum and this is the angular momentum. Now, angular momentum play a central role in both classical mechanics and also we'll discuss the quantum version of this angular momentum in this lecture. Since all isolated system conserve angular momentum, also conserve energy and the linear momentum, as you have discussed in the in your earlier courses, that in the absence of any external force, the linear momentum remains constant, and also in the absence of any external torque, the angular momentum remains constant. And this fact reduces considerably the amount of work required in calculating trajectories of planets, for example, rotation of rigid bodies and many other areas. Now, in quantum mechanics, in the solution of Schrodinger equation in space, we must evaluate the angular components of the wave function directly. Now, the fundamental idea of the dual wave and particle nature of matter are expressed mathematically by means of a wave equation first derived by Schrodinger. Now, this equation describes the atomic and nuclear structures, that is the approach, the quantum mechanic equation describes the subatomic particles and their degenerate energy states and many other problems in terms of the quantum number. So basically all the quantities that you know from the Schrodinger equation that it describes these things in terms of quantum numbers. So in quantum mechanics, angular momentum play a central role in understanding, as I told you, the structure of atoms and other quantum problems that possesses that rotational symmetry. Now, also, you know, just for the sake of the background, you know that like other observable quantities, angular momentum is described in quantum mechanics by an operator. Now, this is in fact a vector operator similar to the momentum operator. However, as we'll shortly see, that to the linear momentum operator, the three component of the angular momentum do not commute. That you already discussed in detail in your quantum course. In quantum mechanics, there are several angular momentum operators. The total angular momentum is usually described by J, which is the sum of two momentum, that is the angular momentum and also the spin. Now, this classical definition of the orbital angular momentum, this L is equal to R cross P, can be carried to the quantum mechanics by interpreting R and P as the operator associated with the position and linear momentum. So the total angular momentum will be the sum of, as I described the mechanism how one evaluates the angular momentum in quantum mechanics. So that total angular momentum will be the sum of the orbital angular momentum and also the spin angular momentum. Now, the spin operator S, that we will describe in the coming slide, but just for the background we are discussing here, that this the operator S represent a type of angular momentum associated with the intrinsic rotation of the particle around an axis. Now, spin is an intrinsic property of a particle. Nearly all elementary particle have spin. Now, that spin, if you remember from your quantum classes, that spin is unrelated to the spatial motion. The existence of the spin angular momentum comes from the experiments such as the Strindberg experiments, in which particle are observed to possess angular momentum, and that cannot be account for the orbital angular momentum alone. That is, so that then it was realized that those subatomic particles, or we can say the elementary particle, possesses some sort of intrinsic angular momentum, and that arises because of the spin. So, as I told you, so the angular momenta will be discussed regarding the nucleons, or we can say nucleus. So the thing that I have described here in the last 3 or 4 minutes, as I told you, is the background of your quantum, or you can say the atomic physics. But the first question is, from where the angular momentum, you can say the orbital angular momentum, arises once we are talking about nucleons. So after the shell model that we will be discussing in this course, you will understand that nucleons moves in average central potential of the nucleus, which gives each a constant angular or we can say constant orbital angular momentum L. So the electrons in the atomic physics possesses the angular momentum due to its due to the potential of the nucleus, so that it acquires that orbital angular momentum, and also it possesses that spin angular momentum. Similarly, the nucleons possesses the angular momentum because of the average central potential of the nucleus, and also the nucleons, that is proton and neutron, are also fermions, so they are spin half particles, and they have that intrinsic spin so that the total angular momentum will be the sum of the orbital angular momentum and the spin angular momentum. So here we will be discussing those two momentums for the nucleus that arises because of the nucleons. So the first one is the orbital angular momentum. Since nucleus is an isolated system, that is, no external torque is acting on the system, as I told you once, in the absence of any external torque, the angular momentum remains constant, so that then its angular momentum is conserved and represented by the orbital angular momentum, orbital quantum number L. As I have shown on the last slide, that these descriptions of the nucleus, or we can say subatomic particles, are governed by the Schrodinger formalism, and that give us solution in terms of these quantum numbers. So as I told you, we will be not going into the actual derivations of these equations, but we will just bring all those definitions to the nucleons, or we can say the nucleus. So you know that this constant angular momentum, because nucleons, or we can say nucleus is an isolated system, so it possesses a constant angular momentum, and that is given by this. As I told you, it is described by this angular orbital quantum number L. There is a bracket here, that is under the root L into L plus 1. Bracket N. So this L is the orbital quantum number restricted to these values, which you already know from the quantum mechanics course or atomic physics course, that is, take the value 0, 1, 2, 3 up to N minus 1, where N is generally known as the principal quantum number. So another thing that you know from the quantum mechanics course, that once we are talking about angular momentum in quantum mechanics, so they are discrete, they cannot vary continuously, but the angular momenta have a quantized values, and those values are linked with these quantum number. For example, the orbital angular momentum quantum number determines the value of this momentum. Now we will see what L equal to 0, L equal to 1, or 1 L is equal to 2 means in just a few minutes. But before I move forward, you should know that these angular momentum quantum number L specifies the shape of the orbital with the particular principal quantum number N, which is the principal quantum number. Now that divides the shell into smaller groups of orbital called substate or sublevels. Usually they are described by the same spectroscopic notation as you have done in the atomic physics. But you should know that this L specifies the shape of the orbital for a particular N, which is the principal quantum number. Now this L equal to 0 means it corresponds to the nucleons, which lies in the S state. So that if it is if we put L is equal to 0, so that means the orbital angular momentum corresponding to the nucleons, which are in the S state, substate S, is having zero momentum. And then if we put just L is equal to 1, and then for the D state you need to put L is equal to 2 here. So those one can find out those quantized angular momenta in for all the different energy states within the nucleus. We will discuss these thing in details in the shell models, but in this part of the course you should know how one can describe the angular momentum of these nucleons. So in the same way as you have discussed that in atomic physics for the electrons in various energy levels, so we'll do with the same spectroscopic notation for the nucleons in different sub-energy levels. Now, another important thing is that this angular momentum L is a function of the position. Also, this is the same idea that you have discussed in the atomic physics, that as this L vector rotates, which is the angular momentum, around the Z, or we can say along the field line, or we can say the Z component, so that the Lx and Lz varies, but the projection along the Z, that is the Z component of the angular momentum, that will remain conserved. And it is the very act of measuring one component of L that makes the others indeterminate. And we usually choose the Z component to be determinate to get this Lz, which is the Lz component of this angular momenta, because of the, as I told you, because of the central potential of the nucleus, so that the Z component can be obtained through this definition H cut ML, where this ML is the magnetic quantum number. Also, from your quantum mechanics course, you know that this quantum number specifies the orientation in space of the orbital of a given energy n and of a given shape L. Now, this number, that is ML equal to 0 plus minus 1 plus minus 2, divide the subshells, that is these subshells, into individual orbitals which holds the electrons, or we can hold the electron in atomic physics, and which hold the nucleons in the nucleus. And you also know that there are 2L plus 1 orbital in each subshells, and thus the S subshell, for example, have only one orbital, because when L is equal to 0 to L plus 1, so it will take only one value, so ML will be 0, so that we will be having only one orbital in the subshell S. Also, for the P state, that is P corresponds to L is equal to 1, so if L is equal to 1, ML will be having a value 2L plus 1, so that it will be having three subshells, or we can say three suborbitals, so that this quantum number ML specifies the orientation in space of the orbital of a given energy. And of course, this Lz is the component of L, so this will be always smaller than the angular momentum, as we have discussed here. That is, the value of Lz will always be smaller than the orbital angular momentum. Now, after this brief overview of the orbital angular momentum, as I told you that the total angular momentum of the nucleons, or we can say the nucleus, arises because of the orbital angular momentum and also the spin angular momentum, as we have discussed what is mean by the spin angular momentum in the first few slides. Now, the intrinsic angular momentum, sometimes known as the spin angular momentum, as in the electronic state in atom, it is required to introduce a new quantum number, which is known as the intrinsic quantum number, or simply the spin, denoted by S, with a value S is equal to 1/2, or generally we can say S is equal to plus minus 1 over 2 for the nucleons. So as I told you that these nucleons are fermions, and those are having spin half particles. So in order to build the concept of the angular moments in the nucleus. We have discussed first the orbital angular momentum, and now we are discussing the spin angular momentum, and then that will be the total angular momentum will be the sum of the two angular momentum. So the spin can be treated as an angular momentum. As I have discussed previously, the definition comes from the same quantum mechanics and the Z component, as I have discussed on my previous slide. But this MS is known as the spin quantum number, and that specifies the orientation of the spin axis. So previously, for the orbital angular momentum, it was LZ, the Z component of the orbital angular, that was H cut times ML, that was magnetic quantum number. Those quantum numbers specifies the orientation of the in space of the orbital, and the spin quantum number specifies the orientation of the spin axis. For example, as in quantum mechanics, an electron can spin in only one or two directions. Sometimes we describe it as spin up or spin down. So in the same way, we'll describe this for the nucleons, since they are also spin half particles, so they can either spin, they can have this spin equal to plus half or minus half. One half. Now, it is often useful to imagine the spin as a vector S with a possible Z component value equal to plus minus H cut. As I told you, that the value of this MS can be plus half or minus half, so we can rewrite the same definition in terms of the value of MS, which is the spin quantum number. So after this overview of the various angular momentum for the subatomic particle that you have discussed in the atomic physics, that these are quantized angular momentum and spin angular momentum. So the total angular momentum for the nucleus will be the sum of the two. So the first thing, that the bound nucleons inside the nucleus, like electrons of the atom, move in a central potential with orbital angular momentum L and spin S, will have a total angular momentum. As I told you, that total angular momentum is the sum of the orbital angular momentum and the intrinsic angular momentum, or we can say the spin angular momentum. The total angular momentum J has the same behavior of orbital angular momentum L and the spin angular momentum S, as we have discussed on the previous slide. So that by definition, this will also be conserved and it is quantized. That is H cut J into J plus 1. As I told you, we are not deriving how these definition arises in quantum mechanics, that you can see in your quantum physics. Course. Now, where this J is the total angular momentum quantum number, then it can be written in terms of the vector sum of the orbital angular momentum and the spin angular momentum. As I told you, for the two situation, that is, if this J is equal to L, which is the orbital angular momentum, plus 1 over 2 for the spin up, and also this J is equal to L minus 1 half, which is for the spin down. That is, if you see this diagram, this is the total angular momentum J, which is the vector sum of the orbital angular momentum, which is having this is the orient the you can say the direction of L. And then we have another vector S, which is plus 1 over 2. So this is spin up, that is, it is aligned to that Z direction, or we can say the field direction. So that this J is L plus S, that is the vector sum of this L plus S. So that this is the the representation of the angular momentum g, and this is the angular orbital angular momentum. Now, if we have instead of plus half, we have minus 1 over 2 for the spin down, so that this is the L vector, and this is the minus 1 over 2, that is the spin down for representation for the spin down nucleons, and then the vector sum is this J, which is the sum of, or we can say the L minus S gives you that J vector, so that the angular momentum is represented by this circle. Now, as we have discussed the Z component, so this can be described as LS plus LZ equal to H cut MJ, where this MJ can have these values. As I have discussed for the one case, that is for when L is equal to 0, this ML will be having 2L plus 1 values. So you can apply the same thing over here, so that you can count the number of orbital, or we can say energy state within the substrate, as we have discussed. So this will be the total angular momentum. Remember, we have discussed for the orbital angular momentum, but you can apply this for the total angular momentum. Also, you know that this MS is having equal to plus minus half, so you left with only ML. So by this, one can say that this J, the Z component of the total angular momentum will depend upon the value of ML, whether that will be an integer or we can say half integer. So since ML is always integer, so that this ML is always integer, so MJ must be half integer. So by this definition, this MJ must be always be half integer. So that these are the possible values of MJ, which comes from these definitions. Now, after discussing these angular momenta, or we can say the various definitions of the angular momentum for the nucleons, now we will see some of the outcomes. For example, the original indication that nuclei have spin come from the atomic spectroscopy. Many lines in atomic spectra, when examined with high resolving power spectroscopes, are found to consist of several lines very close together. And we also discussed that in your previous course, that such lines are said to exhibit hyperfine structures. Now, the description of such hyperfine structures regarding the nucleus, as we are discussing these angular momentum regarding the nucleon, so the description of such hyperfine structures arises because of the two sources. So we have two sources for such hyperfine structures. One, due to the presence of isotopes, and the other has been found in spectral lines of nucleus of single isotopes, such as bismuth 209. So that single isotope gave rise to such hyperstructures, and that is because of the hyperfine structure lines suggested by Pauli for the first time. And just like nucleons inside the nucleus of the atom also spins about an axis and possesses a nuclear angular momentum. Now, we label each nucleons, as we are discussing now the nucleus as a single entity, as we have discussed on this last headings, that just like nucleons inside the nucleus, the nucleus of an atom also spins about an axis and possesses a nuclear angular momentum. So we can say that the angular momentum or the spin angular momentum of the nucleus arises because of these the angular momentum, or you can say the spin of the individual nucleons that give rise to the spin of the nucleus itself. So here we will say that in order to describe the nucleus angular momentum, so we'll be treating nucleus as a single entity instead of describing the individual angular momentum of the nucleon. So we label every nucleon, whether proton or neutron, with the corresponding quantum number L, S, and J, as this corresponds to the orbital angular momentum, this corresponds to the intrinsic spin angular momentum, and this is the total angular momentum. So once each nucleon is labeled with these numbers, so that the nucleus itself will be having a net angular momentum. The total angular momentum of a nucleus having a nucleons, for example, would then be the vector sum of the total angular momentum of all nucleons, J, and it is often called the intrinsic angular momentum or the nuclear spin, and is represented by I. So the spin of the nucleus, or we can say the total angular momentum of the nucleus, is represented by the symbol I. Such that is the vector sum of all the total angular momenta arises from each nucleons. So that is the vector sum. So this is the net angular momenta, we can say the spin of the nucleus arises because of the individual nucleons. Again, the same definition is worked out. It is convenient to work with this version instead of the value I. You know what I mean by this version, that is the average expectation value. And this will be now the quantum number corresponds to the nuclear spin quantum number. For many applications involving angular momentum, the nucleus behaves as if it is a single entity with an intrinsic angular momentum of a value I. So as I have discussed here, so that instead of working with all the nucleons inside the nucleus, just describing it as a single entity, or we can say many applications involving angular momentum, the nucleus behaves as a single entity. Moreover, we observe that the nucleus is a single spinning a particle, that is a single entity. Such that the nuclear angular momentum, for this reason, the nuclear spin I and the corresponding spin quantum number I are used to describe the angular nuclear states, which can take on integral or half integral values, as we have discussed through those definition of L and S. So that for even a nuclei, we can have the spin equal to the integral value, integer, or we can say for even a, so we can have two situation, one which is even z and even n, so that it give rise to total spin equal to zero, and once this the proton number is odd and the neutron number is odd, so that we have a total nucleon even, so then it will be having an integer value. Also, for odd a nuclei, we'll be having odd half integer value of the spin. If this odd a can be obtained from even z odd n, and also odd z even n. So in both situation, we'll be having spin which is odd half integer. Now, further, once we'll be discussing the shell model, we'll be describing how one can obtain the spin of various nuclei or we can say how one can describe it, the nuclei in terms of their spin, or what is the role of the outermost nucleons once we discuss the shell models. Now, the explanation of that is based, that is these values based on the assumption that the spin angular momentum I is a vector sum of the spin and the orbital angular momentums of the particle within the nucleus, and that these spins are aligned with their axis either parallel or antiparallel. Now, the measured values of the nucleus spin can tell us a great deal of the nucleus structure. For example, of the hundreds of known stable as well as the radioactive elements having even Z and even N configuration, all have spin zero ground state, and this is the we can say the evidence for the nuclear pairing force that we have discussed in our previous lecture. So with this, I thank you for your time.